Praise God. I'm looking at the clock and I see we're running early this morning. That means I get an hour and a half for the sermon. I realize I might be very lonely at the end of that hour and a half, but you know, God is good. And, you know, I think of, yes, it's by commandment that we observe the Lord's Sabbath. But it's also a precious privilege given only to us by the shed blood of the risen Savior. There's not a single one of us in here who shouldn't feel very, very privileged to be here, that the Lord would want us to gather in His presence. A people who at one time were not a people. A people who He sent His only begotten Son into this world to die and make a people. Two of my most favorite words in the Bible are the two words, whosoever will. I'm one of the whosoever's. You're one of the whosoever will. Just choose me, Jesus says, choose life. It's such a wonderful thing. Let's ask the Lord's blessing this morning with us. Father in heaven, we thank you so much, Lord, for your goodness, for your grace, for your mercy, for your love, for your watch care over us. Lord, for all the ways that you look after us. And Lord, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die upon a mean, cruel cross for us. Lord, that we could have the right, the privilege, Lord, to be part of your commandment-keeping people, to be gathered here on the Sabbath day, to have the blessed hope, Lord, to look forward to your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to come back soon. We know His coming is soon. We want to be prepared, Lord. We want to help as many people as we can possibly help to be prepared also to meet Him in peace when He comes. We ask you, Lord, to give us ears to listen to what you have to say this morning. Take a call from heaven's altar, Lord, and touch these lips of mine, that everything I say would be your words, would be your message, Lord, to the end that we can all do a better job of glorifying you than we even do right now. And Lord, that again, that we can not just be ready ourselves, but to encourage as many others as we possibly can to be ready for your Son's soon return. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Again, God is good, and He loves us, and He's done all this for us, and I think the Lord deserves a hand this morning. I believe the Lord. Now, I know that we're Seventh-day Adventists, and we don't clap in church, but we do sometimes, don't we? Well, there are certain occasions when we give people a hand and when we congratulate them. And you know, my Bible tells me that when one sinner comes to repentance, all of heaven rejoices. You know? So I believe it's okay to rejoice in the Lord and let the Lord know that we love Him and let Him know that we appreciate Him. And you know, we're always quick to go to each other, pat them on the back, high-five them, good job, this or that. Well, we can tell the Lord, good job. Thank you, Lord. We appreciate everything that you do. God inhabits the praises of His people. And I don't know about you, but I like knowing that God is with me all the time. God is wonderful. God, the love of God is poured out through every page of His precious book that He has given us. And I think about the scripture that we read for this morning, and I think about, I want to go in reverse order on that scripture. I want to start with the last verse first, where it talks about they overcame Him, how? By the blood of the, and by the word of their. I wonder if there's one person here that's got a testimony this morning. Something that the Lord's done, something that talks about the glory of the Lord, something that you're just going to burst if you don't get to tell us about it this morning. Anybody with a testimony this morning? Hang on. We all want to hear it. We all want to hear it. Is that on?
Yes, it's on. Praise God, everybody. The Lord has worked a miracle in my life. I was suffering from this headache, waking me out of my sleep. And praise God, from I went to Shan's Hospital and back, I do not have any headache. So praise God for that. And he worked a miracle for me again. I don't have any tumor, and I'm praising the Lord for that. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. One more. Has anybody got one more testimony? Oh, okay.
I'll start. She can finish. This spring, I was diagnosed with mesothelioma. No, not mesothelioma. Lymphoma. Mantle lymphoma. Cancer. And that's kind of hits you kind of hard. And we had some very emotional times and things, and had some studies done and everything. And it was not very aggressive at the time, and I'm very blessed with that. And the nodes at the time, and this was February, whatever, they said were like 2.2 millimeters. Oh, okay, fine. So the doctor said, you know, if it was me or if it was a family member, we would watch it. And I said, okay, you're the doctor, we'll do with that. Now you have cancer in you. It's kind of like, you know, I'm not real wild about that, but, you know, the powers to be, the Lord impressed me that this is a good doctor. And so we said, well, we're going to trust in what you say. So this last month, I found out, by the way, that I do not like MRI machines, those little teeny tubes. They're not my favorite friend. So we have to try and find a machine that works for me. But anyway, so we had some screening done. We set up a thing on a quarterly basis. We'd do screening. And so a couple weeks ago, I had another screening, and I met with the doctor. And the doctor comes in, and he goes, so Bill, he says, What are you doing? And I'm going, well, I'm just following your directions. I says, I've got a lot of people praying for me. And I says, but other than that, we're just kind of trying to do the right thing and eat good and sleep good and all that. And he goes, well, whatever it's doing, it's working.
Amen. And praise I went, the Lord.
Oh, really? And he says, yeah. He says, you're now down to, instead of 2.2 millimeters, are 1.7 millimeters. I says, praise the Lord. I said, prayer works. So I feel real blessed about how things are progressing, but yeah.
Amen. Thank you for sharing that. Praise the Lord. One more. Becky.
So many things to praise the Lord for, but I found a new rheumatologist. And he was going over history. And, you know, oftentimes we forget where the Lord has brought us from. So kind of sharing with him some of the history that 2010-ish, well, 2013 is when I found out I had the rheumatoid arthritis and the Sjogren's syndrome. And at that time, I could not open a doorknob, I couldn't wash my hair, I couldn't stir a pot, I couldn't do personal care things. And, you know, God is so good, and he's restored and put my illness in remission and restored the use of my hands and my feet to serve him over in the center, and I just praise him for that.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Praise God. In the mouth of two or three witnesses. Isn't it wonderful to know that God is one day going to restore us to the original perfection that man was created in? All of these diseases, all these ailments are going to be a thing of the past. And they're going to fade into a distant memory. And then they're going to disappear from memory altogether. How do we know that? Because God promised no more tears. There's not going to be anything to sorrow. Can you imagine not having anything to sorrow over? Whatever shall we do at the time? When you read about The creatures around the throne, what are they doing? They're praising God. How often do they praise God? Continually, all day, all night, all the next day, all the next night, continually praising God. And it may be hard for us to imagine, you know, as much as we love the Lord, could we praise Him where to us it might get to the point of being come mundane, of being old, of being repetitious? Well, that's possible. That's possible, but I believe that with them, it's always spontaneous. When I read that scripture, I get the idea that it's always spontaneous, fresh praise. Because I believe that every time they praise God, they discover something else to praise God for. Amen. How many of us are surprised to find out that God is a miracle working God? Oh, I'm so shocked. Oh, thank you, Lord. Praise God. We shouldn't be surprised to find out about the power of our God and how much He loves us and how willing He is to reach down a blessing, to reach down a miracle, to pass down an answer to prayer. He's a God who loves to hear from His people, and we are some of His people. We're not all of His people, but we are some of His people. And you know, we live in turbulent times. We live in what can be discouraging times. We live in very unsure times, and everybody's looking for answers. Unfortunately, not everybody's looking for Christ. Actually, they are. They just don't know it's Him they're looking for. Amen. But everyone's looking for answers, and they want peace. They want love. They want security. They want happiness. They want stability. They want to know that they've got a future. Amen. Well, in Jesus Christ, we have our future. Outside of Christ, there is no future. This human history is soon to come to a very abrupt end, isn't it? A very abrupt end. It's just going to be, that's going to be the end of it. And there are people who don't understand, who don't believe that. They're preparing for time to go on, or human history to keep going on and on and on forever and forever and forever. Well, it's not. We know that we're going to, that the Christians are going to one day re-inhabit this earth. Praise God. I think about God moving the center of His universal government to this earth. This sinful old planet, this rogue planet, this rebellious planet that turned against Him, one day is going to be the seat of God's universal government. What do you think about that? Amen. Amen. And we are all invited to be part of that. Every single one of us, we are all invited to be part of that. But you know, we have an enemy out there, don't we? Amen. We have an enemy. But you know, when we read that verse 11, and they overcame Him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, there's a third part to that equation. And they loved not their lives unto the death. They loved not their lives. In other words, there was nothing too good to withhold from Jesus. There was nothing more precious than Jesus. Their fame, their fortune, whatever, a job, saving face, how they looked to their friends, who might say what or who might say anything, was not as important as their relationship with Jesus Christ. We have to have an absolutely vital connection with Jesus Christ, don't we? It has to be unshakable. It has to be unbroken if we are going to live in these times and if we are going to make it through with our faith in Christ intact. Right? Who are God's people? Those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Not just the faith in Jesus, but the faith of Jesus. How faithful, not just was, but how faithful is Jesus? But when He was here in person, how faithful was He? Did He ever doubt His Father? Did He ever break the commandments? Did He ever second guess His Father or refuse to do anything His Father had asked? Why? Because He trusted His Father. That's trust in knowing that even if I'm nailed to the cross, this is not the end of it for me. He knew His Father was going to raise Him from the dead. And he knew what that crucifixion and resurrection would accomplish. And he looked down through the corridors of time and he saw you and me sitting here today. And he said, for them, if it's possible, Father, let this cup pass from me. Nonetheless, not my will be done, but yours. I'll do it for them. That's who I came for. I came for my people. I'll do it for them. Well, it can get discouraging because we have this enemy. And verse 17 of chapter 12 said, and the dragon was enraged with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed. Okay, who are the remnant of her seed? Again, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. The remnant of her seed. Okay, a remnant is a big, huge chunk, right? No. A remnant is a small piece. A small piece. And sometimes it can get discouraging because we can feel like, well, you know, we're just a small piece. Seventh-day Adventists, 20 million maybe? On an earth where the population is 7+ billion, what's 20 million? You could put that on the point of a pin and still have room left over. That's not very much. But, you know, the Bible tells us to not be swayed by such things because our God is a powerful God. And our God is an awesome God. And he's left us some instruction. When I look at Brother James, chapter 4 and verse 7, I hope y'all brought two things with you. I hope you brought your Bibles. And I hope you brought your nimble fingers, your page-turning fingers. You're going to find that helpful this morning. James 4:7, he writes, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he'll hang around a little longer. No, that's not what your Bible says? Mine doesn't either. Mine says he will flee from you. When that discourager comes along, when the one who says you're never going to make it, when the one who says it's all in vain, when the one who tries to remind you how good everything was in your life before Jesus, the Bible says to resist the devil. But first, before we can resist him, we have to do what? Amen. Jesus resisted the devil, didn't he? His whole life upon this earth. But what did he do before that? After his baptism, he got straight up and he went into the wilderness. And he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And he wasn't playing bingo in there. He was praying to his Father. He was overcoming. He was overcoming the temptations. He was overcoming the things that he could have slipped and fallen into that would have disqualified him as the Messiah, as the Savior, as the one who was going to come and redeem a fallen race, a fallen people. And if that had happened, we wouldn't be sitting here today. There'd be no reason. We may have destroyed each other a long time ago. There'd be no reason to be gathered here. There'd be no hope. There'd be no joy. It's only by the blood of the Lamb that we sit here and the word of our testimony. You see, testimony has to come. That's why I ask for testimony. The people of God have to testify. The people of God have to tell each other about Jesus. And it doesn't matter whether you've just come to Christ yesterday or whether you've been walking with Christ for years, whether you've got a big, gripping, explosive testimony, or if all you can say is, praise God, I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb. That's enough. That's enough. That will touch somebody. You see, Jesus talked about faith, right? As tiny as a grain of mustard seed. God does a lot with small little seeds. God loves tiny seeds. Because he knows that in and of ourselves, you and I aren't very much. Amen? Believe me, when Christ came, when he decided, when I asked him into my life and asked him to save me, and he accepted, he got the raw end of the deal. I'll tell you that right now. He got the raw end of the deal, yet he knew exactly what he was getting, and he said, come on, I'll take you on anyway. With each and every one of us, he got the raw end of the deal, but he accepted, and he knew that going in. He knew that ahead of time. Amen? I tell people all the time, getting Jim out of the world, getting Jim to Jesus was the easy part. It's getting the world out of Jim where God has his work cut out for him. Amen. It's getting the world out of us. Now, when we each have our own story of when we, of how we came to the cross, of how we came to Christ, of how we decided to accept him into our life, and we can say, yeah, I saw the Lord working with me here and here and here, and I sure was a tough cookie. I was not an easy mark at all for the Lord. I sure put him through the paces. Nothing like the paces you're putting him through now. But he's a patient God, and he loves us, and he wants us to be with him. So he has made sure that we can't fail. But resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Well, again, it can be intimidating because the devil doesn't make himself this big. He makes himself this big, and he looms over us, and he breathes down our neck like a dragon. You know, I often say in Genesis he was a snake. By the time we get to Revelation, he was a dragon. Somebody fed him. Somebody's been feeding him. He makes himself seem larger than life. He makes himself seem like he's all we can see. But like the song that we sang this morning for song service, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. And Jesus said that he has overcome the world. The Bible promises that he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Amen? Now, it's easy to feel like we're overwhelmed, like we're outnumbered, but if we turn to 2 Kings chapter 6 for just a minute, 2 Kings chapter 6, there's something that we want to look at here. 2 Kings chapter 6 and verse 16. It's a story about when the Syrians were going to attack. And Elisha was on the scene. And he was there that day. And 2 Kings chapter 6 and verse 16, I'll begin at 15. The Syrians had him surrounded. And when the servant of the man of God, who was Elisha, was risen early and gone forth, behold, a host surrounded the city, an army surrounded the city with both horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, alas, my master, how shall we do? Or what are we going to do about this? How are we going to get out of this? And just like the prophet of God, Elisha says, relax. You know, whenever the devil's got you all spun up, Jesus says, relax. Didn't he? Peace be with you. Lord, we're going to drown. The boat's going to sink. Peace be with you. Relax. And he said this. He said, fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. And they were outnumbered. They were ready to get slaughtered, and they knew it. And he said, those that are with us are more than those that are with them. You know, and we know that Elijah, after he had just showed them who the Lord was on Mount Carmel, and he slew all the prophets of Baal, and then one little threat from Jezebel sent them running into hiding, and the Lord came to him, and what did he say? Lord, I'm the only one left in all of Israel that serves you, and those enemies of yours, they're seeking my life. I'm the only one that's still standing for you. And what did the Lord finally tell him? I've got 5,000 yet reserved to me in Israel who have not bowed the knee to Baal and have not kissed him. So we're not alone. We're not alone at all. You plus Jesus are a majority. It doesn't matter where we go, what the situation is, you in and of yourself, me in and of myself are nothing. But Jesus is a majority. But he calls us alongside to work with him. We're to work with him. Now, if we go back to Revelation 5:11, we're going to see something here. Revelation chapter 5 and verse 11. John, in prophetic vision, was looking up into heaven. How many of you would like to look into heaven? We know Sister White looked into heaven, don't we? Amen. I don't want to just look into heaven. I want to be in heaven. But John was looking up into heaven. He said, and I looked, I beheld, and I heard the voice of two or three angels. Many angels, right? Many angels round about the throne and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, which by the way is 100 million, and thousands of thousands. Amen? Those that are with us are more than those that are against us. Those that are with us are more than those that are against the enemy. The angels, the unfallen angels, still have eternity with God. Satan and the fallen angels have a limited number of days left. The Bible said that's why Satan is so busy, because he realizes that he has a short time. And I don't want to give him any credit or any credence, but I'm going to say that Satan every day is as busy as the church ought to be. Amen? Because he understands that it's almost curtains for him. He knows that. He'll never admit it to you and I, but he understands. And he is as busy every day as the church ought to be. Because we need to realize how time the short is, how short the time is, and how little time we have left to do the work that God has called the church. And not just us, I mean the church at large. There are millions and millions and millions of Christians all over the world who are all looking for Jesus to come, and they're all doing the very best they know how to make that happen. And not all of them are Seventh-day Adventists. Because God looks into the other churches and he says, come out of her, my people. Amen. God looks into our hearts and he sees what error we may still be harboring. He sees things that we may still be unclear on. And he said, look, I want to show you this. I want to teach you this. I want you to understand this better. Why? So we can better serve him and better be able to reach out to our neighbor, to reach out to those who God loves. You and I will never, ever look into the eyes of somebody who God does not love. It doesn't matter who they are, where they are, what's going on in their life, whether you would cross the street and walk as far around them as you could get. It doesn't matter. You'll never look into the eyes of anybody who God does not love. You'll never look into the eyes of one single person who Jesus Christ did not die for. You know, when he returns, he wants them all. He wants them all. He didn't sit there and divide between the two, say, I'll save this one, but not that one. I'll save this one. No, he wants them all. Unfortunately, he knows he's not going to get them all. But he wants them all. And he wants you and I to go after each and every person as though they are going to get saved, as though they are going to come to Christ and accept him as personal Lord and Savior and be walking with him. When you look at the despair that so many walk around in. So, you know, I had a former pastor of mine, he's passed away now, but he talked about people who it's hard to understand why they do. Why are they living like that? Why is that in their life? Why do they do it? He said, you know what? If you go and ask them the right way, they might tell you. You see, Jesus knew how to ask people the right way. Jesus knew how to get people to sit down and open up to him. And if we just ask him how to do it, he'll show us how. Amen? But God is so wonderful. I want to, we want to go back to Revelation chapter 12 now and verse 6. There's lots of hope in verse 6. It doesn't sound like it on the surface, but there's loads of hope in verse 6. And the woman, who is the woman? The church. The woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared of God. God prepared the woman a place where? In the midst of the fray. God prepared a place for his church that they should feed her there for 1,203 score days. Now this, again, was in the midst of the persecution. This was in the midst of the trials. This was in the midst of the burning at the stakes and being pulled apart on the racks and being thrown into the dungeons. In the midst of all that, what did it say about the church, about the woman? She was being fed. Somebody was feeding the woman. Somebody was taking care of the woman. Somebody was making sure the woman didn't get wiped out. Somebody was making sure that the woman would live to fight another day. You and I can count on the very same God that was there then to be here today. There is nothing that will befall us, nothing that will come in our lives that, number one, God didn't already see long before you and I did. And if it's happening in your life, it doesn't necessarily mean God approved it or God sent it, but it does mean God allowed it. God has his perfect will, amen, and he has his permissive will. There are certain things that he wouldn't have to go on, but he will allow to go on if it'll bring you and I closer to Christ. If it'll give you and I that wake-up call or somebody else that wake-up call that they need, that will eventually rouse their spirit and stir them up and get them to come to Christ. Because without Christ, what hope does anybody have? You take everything that you understand about God, what good would any of it be without Christ? What good would any of it do you without Christ? Christ is the blessed hope. Christ is the one who's returning for us. Christ is the one who washes us free from the guilt of our sins. He reaches into the muck and the mire. He pulls us out of there. He sets our feet upon a solid rock and gives us solid ground to walk on. And he takes us by the hand. He says, come with me. Christ is not ashamed to be associated with you and I. Praise God. And I look at my own case, I say, whew. Praise God. God is good. God is patient. God is love. And God is there for his people. And if we go right over to verse 14 again, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness into her place where she is nourished for a time, and half a time from the face of the serpent. Again, that's the 1260 years we know of persecution that the Christians went through under the papal church. We know that there were at least 50 million, if not 150 million, who were slain because they wouldn't bow, because they said no, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we'll burn before we'll bow. We'll burn before we'll bow. But you know what? This God nourished the woman in the wilderness. She was given a way of escape. The woman, the church, was given the means to go through and live through whatever she had to live through upon this earth. You and I are here because of the efforts of people who lived through that time and who smuggled Bibles and who took scriptures and sewed them into their hems of their clothing and went other places and passed them out. Those who were willing to go to the guillotine, to the stakes, to the dungeons, and all kinds of other unmentionable, just totally inhuman torture devices and so forth in the name of Jesus Christ, because they love not their lives unto the death. That's why you and I have the faith today. And what the Lord is calling his people back to is back to the primitive faith that they had. You know, we've been studying the book of Acts in our quarterlies. That was the last quarterly, was the book of Acts. And it's been an incredible study. God is calling his people back to the faith once delivered to the saints. The simple faith of do or die, I will stand with Christ. I will stand for Christ, whatever may come. It's not too great a price to be asked. And I will do it because my Savior did it for me. Jesus Christ stood for you and I. I think about Pilate after he scourged Christ and brought him back out and said, "Behold the man." If he were guilty, he wouldn't be looking like this. If he were guilty, after about the third lashing, he would have sung like a canary and he wouldn't have been whipped the way he was. We know Jesus took the full 40 lashes minus one and came out. Christ came that you and I might have life. He came that your neighbor might have life. He came that the ones in our lives, your life and my life, who don't know the Lord, might come to know the Lord. He told us to be an example. He said, "Let your light so shine that others may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." And sometimes we can have trouble letting our light shine because this world gets on us. You know, we have to live in this world. We have to make it through this world. We have to function in this world. And sometimes, you know, this world can dampen our spirits. We get knocked down all the time. But God's people put their hand, that nail-scarred hand of Jesus, and they get back up. And they let God recondition us. They let God reignite us. They let God refire us and send us back out to do his bidding for yet another day, because somebody is out there depending on you and depending on me to tell them about Jesus. Even those who don't know it yet. You know, when I think about Sister White's book, The Desire of Ages, I've read that so many times. But I think about that, what that means. It's what everybody wants. Christ is the answer. Christ is what everybody wants. But not everybody understands that. Not everybody accepts it. Not everybody is willing to know that. But he embodies, he is the embodiment of everything that the world wants. He is love. He is peace. He is security. He is stability. He is peace of mind. He is spiritual strength. He is physical strength. He is mental strength. He, all the things. He is the one who will take away the stress. He is the one. He is the Lord, our healer. Amen? He is the one that everybody is looking for, but so few turn their eyes to. And there are people out there who need and who are looking for the answers, not that he provides. Jesus Christ doesn't provide any answers. Jesus Christ is the answer. Jesus Christ doesn't give life. Jesus Christ is life. He said, "I am the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life." And he said, "All power on heaven, in heaven and on earth has been given unto me." And he said, "All you have to do is ask in my name." Here, all, here, guys, here, my people, all power has been given to me, and here's the key. I'm giving every single one of you the key that unlocks the power. Because God knows the end from the beginning. There are still lots of details in this book that have yet to be opened up to all of our understanding. God knows them inside and out. God knows what He's looking for in His people. God knows why He called His people out, the called out ones. Why He called Abraham out. He said, come apart, Abraham. And we're all descendants because of the blood of Christ. We're all descendants of Abraham, aren't we? Amen. We are spiritual Israel, God's church, God's end time church. Those who have been called at such a time as this, you know, and Satan will do his best to discourage, again, to downplay, and, you know, he likes to tell us, you're nobody, you know, and that's okay. I don't know about you, but I'm okay with being nobody. I'm just a nobody who's trying to tell everybody about somebody who will save anybody. Amen. He will save anybody. Anybody walking this earth. There's not a single one that Jesus says, oh, I'm not interested in him. I'm not interested in her. They're too far gone. Is anybody too far gone for Jesus to reach? Where there's breath, there's hope. Amen. So if they're living and breathing and they're 1,000 miles away from Christ, you and I better be praying for them. If they won't let you talk to them, Jesus will let you talk to him. Amen. So let's not go psh, 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 and whisper to your friend or your neighbor about that other guy or that other girl. No, don't whisper. Open your mouth and fully, but open it to Jesus. Say, Lord, I don't understand what's going on, but I see trouble in that person's life. I see trouble in so-and-so's life. First, correct my vision, right? He said, pull the plank out of your own eye before you try to take the toothpick out of your neighbor's eye. First, correct my vision, Lord. First, adjust my vision. First, cause me to see properly. And then, Lord, whatever they need, bless their socks off, Lord Jesus. Touch them. Heal them. Open the eyes of their heart and lighten their mind, Lord. Show them what it is that they need to have. Show them that you are who they need. And that's not an easy path because we put up a lot of resistance to the Lord. And you know, even after we come to Christ, we still don't stop putting up resistance, do we? Because we have to still continually pray, Lord, break down my will. Lord, make my desire, make your desires my own. And still give me your heart and still your desires in me that I may go forth and do your work, not because of me, but because of my neighbor. See, Jesus saved you because he's got your neighbor in mind. He loves you and he wants you, but you have your own little corner of this world that you influence. Each and every one of us has our own sphere of influence in this world. And he's interested in you, but he's interested in everybody else who you can touch. Because they all need Jesus. They all need Jesus. And as brothers and sisters in Christ, we all need Jesus as well because we are the special target of the enemy. Once a person comes to Christ, there's a line drawn in the sand, and Satan says, okay, game on. And so our brothers and sisters need our uplifting in prayer, maybe more than anybody else. Because, you know, look at the person sitting next to you. Look at the person sitting across the room. You have no idea how close some of them may be to falling away. I've seen it happen. I've seen it happen where people who are rocks and pillars. healers, and they're there every service, and they're this and that, and then 2 months later, you can't find them. They're gone. Oh, what happened to brother so-and-so? Oh, sad story. He went back out into the world. Better stay away from him. No. No. We better go after him. What would Jesus do? Jesus would go after him. He leaves the 99, amen, who are okay, and he goes after the one that found a hole in the fence and got out. Amen? And that's what we need to be doing. Your neighbor who you've been trying to talk to about Jesus or get a Bible study with, and they keep slamming the door on it, just telling you no, okay, well, pray for them. Say, Lord, you can do a better job than I did. Stop in that knucklehead's heart. And then before you know it, they're going to knock on your door and say, hey, how about those Bible studies you're talking about? When can we start? See, that's how God works. Amen. Because, you know, I heard someone say this a long time ago, and it always touched me. Jesus will touch you in a place that mama can't. And mama will touch you in a place nobody can. But Jesus will touch you in a place that mama can't. Amen. Jesus knows where that sweet spot is, and he knows how to put his finger right on it. And if we pray, and we pray, you know why you're here? Because somebody prayed for you. I'm here because somebody prayed for me and never gave up, and they kept on and they kept laboring, and they went out into the Lord's field and kept laboring and kept laboring and kept laboring and said, yeah, Lord, he's an awful tough case. But you know, if anybody can do it, Lord, you can. And we all have that brother, that sister, that cousin, that auntie, that uncle, somebody, that neighbor, that coworker, who's just as thick as a piece of granite, boy. Nothing is going to penetrate that guy. Jesus can touch him in a place that mama can't. You and I don't know where that spot is, but Jesus does. Amen. And we and again, anytime you feel outnumbered, you think of all the heavenly host who haven't fallen. Can anybody tell me how many citizens there are of the unfallen worlds? We don't know. But God likes to create. And God likes to create beauty. And God likes to create perfection. And God likes to make things just so. And he didn't just stop at this one little orb right here. So whenever you feel outnumbered, whenever Satan tries to make you feel outnumbered, whenever somebody else who Satan is working through tries to make you feel like you're insignificant, like you're outnumbered, think of all the billions of other people of God out there in the unfallen worlds, and all of a sudden you realize what a majority you're a part of. Because those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus are more than those who don't. Amen? Those who are with us are more. It doesn't matter any day of the week, any hour of the day, those who are with us are more than those who are against us. You see, Satan is a defeated foe, and he's dangerous because he's injured. Mainly his ego, I guess. But anybody will tell you that the most dangerous animal is an injured animal. Satan is a defeated foe, and he knows it, but he also knows how short his time is. But he knows how powerful God is. His very existence, no matter what he may do, no matter what he try to make you or I think, no matter how he blasphemes and how wide he opens his mouth, he depends upon God for his existence. Think about that. The enemy of your soul, the accuser of the brethren, depends upon Jesus Christ for his existence. God has the power over his existence, and we know he's going to end his existence one day. He and all of his cohorts, they depend upon the God who they hate, the God who they cursed, the God who they rebelled against. They depend upon him for their existence. Amen. You and I depend upon that very same God for our existence. But he said that if we would put our faith in him, and that faith means just beyond, oh yes, I believe in Jesus. No, we have to put, some of us are going to be here for those real testing times, I believe. I mean, maybe we're all old enough that we don't have to worry that we're going to be clear and out of here or in the ground before all that, but we don't know. If we expect Jesus back any day, and I sure hope it's any day, today would be fine with me. I don't know about the rest of y'all, but we have to realize that we depend upon him also for our existence. But he has told us that he is dependable. We know that God is dependable, and we know that those who sleep in Christ are going to be raised to new life, and those who are alive when he comes back are going to be translated and caught up with them. This God is able, and your dependence upon him and your faith in God and my faith in God is extremely well placed. It can't be placed in any better spot, any better place. There's nobody else to go to. But he is fully able, and he will deliver on every single promise he has made. Our God is an awesome God, and he's a wonderful God. And he's a God that loves each and every one that he's created. He loves all of his creation. It breaks his heart. And I don't know how God's heart feels, but I try to think about it. Lord, if one person, even one person, dies outside of Jesus Christ, if they die without Christ, what it must do to your heart. What it must do to his heart. God created us with the idea of losing none of us. When he created Adam and Eve, our first parents, it was with the idea of losing none. Amen? It was with the idea of future generations, of living in complete and total blessing upon this earth, never knowing a moment's hardship, never knowing a moment's pain, never knowing a heartache, never knowing as much as a sniffle. And Satan came in, we all know, and promised Eve what she already had. What she already had. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Those are still the weapons he uses. He may repackage them. He may use a different looking gun today than he did yesterday, but it's the same weapon. And he does it time and time again. But you and I can stand firm and stand strong in Jesus Christ if we just totally put our trust in him. And I know that's said over and over and over again. But if we don't put our faith in God, if we don't put our faith in Jesus Christ, then there is no hope. There's no hope. And he is faithful, and he is able to bring every single one of us through. Amen. So remember, sometimes he calms the storm. Other times he calms the child through the storm. Amen. He delivered Noah and his family and those who were on the ark with him through the storm. They had to ride it out. I'll bet there were some, I don't know if it's right to say anxious moments, but for lack of a better word, I'll bet there were some anxious moments in that ark. When it was heaving up and slamming down and rolling and pitching, and it sounded like the world was coming to an end out there, because it was, or so it seemed, for 40 days and 40 nights. I'll bet there were some anxious moments. I'll bet there was a lot of real intense prayer aboard that ark. What do you think? And you know what? I believe that that is going on around us right now. We're just, I don't know, maybe we just feel insulated from how horrible it is out there. And in this country, maybe we are. There's brothers and sisters in Christ who are suffering horrendous things in other parts of the world that you and I don't hear about on the daily news. Every day they're suffering these things. There are children in some countries, little kids, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old, accepting Christ and being disowned by their families. Thrown out because of their witness for Jesus Christ. There are those who can't freely get up and go to church and drive and stroll in like you and I do. They have to sneak. They got to hide. They got to gather in secret because they might get slaughtered while they're at worship today. We don't know what that's like. And we need to use the freedom that we have while we have it. It's not going to last. If you read Revelation, if you read about the mark of the beast being in force, you know that even here, church and state are going to combine, and it's going to be back to persecution just like history teaches. Only it's not going to be history, it's going to be today. It's going to be now. So we have to be able to go through with our faith intact, with our walk with Jesus Christ intact, and be able to understand, to be able to help others to understand why they need Christ. Why should I come to Christ right now? Look what's happening to you guys. Well, yeah, but here's what's going to happen if you don't. And because he died by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, and they love not their lives unto the death. One day you're not going to be able to carry one of these around anymore. And you're going to have to share whatever's in here. Whatever's locked up in here. Whatever's stored away in here. And there's going to have to be enough in here to be able to help somebody understand why they must come to Christ. Why they need Christ. Because when you run into someone who needs him, and you have to say, oh, I don't know enough about it, that's not going to get it. Just not going to get it. So we just need to pray and ask God to pour out his Spirit upon us, to renew our hearts, to renew our minds, and renew our commitment to him. Is there anyone who feels like they need to renew their commitment to Christ? I know I do. On a daily basis, I need to renew my commitment to him. I need his power and his strength in my life. Is there anybody here today who does not know Jesus Christ? You've never accepted him. You've never asked him into your life to be your Lord and Savior. Because if you're here today and that's you, believe me when I say you do not want to walk out of here the same way you walked in. Even if you do know Christ, you don't want to walk out of here. I don't want to walk out of here the same way I walked in. I walked in here needy, spiritually needy, because even as well as I think, as I like to tell myself I'm doing, I just look at Jesus and say, oh no, that's all I can do. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Don't leave today without knowing Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior if you don't know him. Father in heaven, we thank you for your love. We thank you for the mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the grace that brought salvation to us. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be gathered here and the great privilege to be called by your name. Help us, Lord. Help us to walk hand in hand with you, to walk in lockstep with you. Lord, that we can yes, grow personally, Lord, stronger, but Lord, that we might be able to encourage our neighbors, our friends, co-workers, people who we rub elbows with on a daily basis to come to faith in Christ or come to a greater, stronger, firmer faith in Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to be fit and to be always ready to do your work. Give us soft hearts, Lord. Let us break before you so that you can do that which you would do with us, so you can use us. Lord Jesus, you never used anything unless it could be broken. Let our own will be broken, Lord. Let us lay down at your feet, present ourselves before you, and accept whatever it is you've got for us when you help us up. Help us, Lord, to be your representatives, your ambassadors, and ever faithful, Lord Jesus, until you return in glory. Amen.